Okay, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أما بعد so we've been discussing the scholars of Islamic economic thought, especially the classical scholars. So I think today we are going to talk about the another scholar from Andalusia. His name is Ibn Hazm. This scholar actually has done a number of work. It's around 400 works. It's been recorded that he has done around 80,000 pages that he has written in many areas, starting from fiqh. That is his main area, main expertise in fiqh, and also he wrote many things in lugha, language, philosophy, and also as well as hadith and tafsir. But unfortunately, only 40 works has been published. Most of his work been lost. Many other scholars of his time, in their books, when they talk about his work, they mention his name and also his name of this work, but unfortunately it's not quite available, most of it. But whatever it's available, it's also it's a huge work. Many scholars used to say this, his work is one of the encyclopedia of fiqh. If someone has to find out any, because he's been he written volumes and after volumes, so if you need to look into the number of opinions of scholars of his time and also the time before him, he used to record everybody's thought, though sometimes he is very harsh when it comes to criticism. So some of the places he use very strong words against scholars. Other than that, the work is an immense contribution to the encyclopedia of fiqh, especially the work of Muhalla. It's called Muhalla bil Athar. I think that is the book I think I have given you in the course outline. It's a huge book, by the way. It's not one volume, by the way. Most of it is starting from fiqh, starting from Kitab al-Tawheed and so on. So he almost covered the entire chapters that are related to human life, not only herein and also hereafter. So mashallah, he has done a fantastic work has been done. But a couple of things we can actually discuss him, especially why he was called Ibn Hazm Dahiri. What is the purpose of saying the word Al-Dahiri? Because Al-Dahiri is not actually his family name, by the way. Some of us might misunderstand. Ibn Hazm, this is the is the grandfather name is actually Ibn Hazm. His name is Ali. People call him Ibn Hazm al-Dahiri. The word al-Dahiri has something to do with his jurisprudence, the way, the methodology that he used to advocate his work in especially fiqh al-ibadat and fiqh al-mu'amalat. That is one thing. The other thing is we also need to find out his contribution in economic thought. What are the work he has done in his book Muhalla bil Athar? Frankly speaking, he is not the scholar of economic thought, but he has also given it is he has no book like Imam Abu Yusuf or Imam Abu Ubaid, like we discussed earlier. He has no separate book like Kitab al-Kharaj or Kitab al-Amwal, like we discussed earlier. But he has done something. He was critically he was critically review some of his thought with regard to land tax and also especially the zakat and payment and distribution. So of course we're gonna discuss that, and after that I also want to discuss with you his thinking of socialism, because some of the scholars are still referring him as a socialist scholar, but we need to see there are differences between our socialism and the so-called whether it is a Russian or non-Russian socialism. That one is also is there, so I think we can discuss a little bit about all these in this class, hopefully, inshallah. So starting from his background, he is let me just start with a story of two scholars. It's quite interesting to know. I think this story can give you a background of his life. There were two scholars were meeting each other, and the first scholar told the other scholar, he said, I have put more effort in learning languages and knowledge and all, pursuing studies and learning, but you have pursued all the languages, knowledges, and all the studies, having all the help you need. Meaning to say, I worked hard to learn this ilm, this knowledge, but it was quite easy for you because you were a rich person and I was a poor person. I had to, because while you were you had a gold plated lamp that you were using to study something, and I was actually using the street light to learn something. So this is what the first scholar talking to the second scholar. And then the second scholar, he replied saying that perhaps this argument may go against you, not for you. It may go against you. How? He said, the second scholar, he said, you pursued your studies when you were in such conditions in the hope that one day you will be becoming a big scholar and you will be having, you will be having all the kind of needs you are supposed to have earlier, and you will be prized by people. So there may be one of the reason that you are working hard to learn something in order to get that famous, in order to get that and fulfillment of the need. But in my case, the second caller is referring, because the second scholar is the wealthy scholar, right? So he is referring by himself, but me, I already have that famous name and family name, and also I am rich, and my needs all fulfilled. So when I am learning something, when I am seeking something, it's purely for the purpose of Allah, the purely to get the satisfaction, to get Allah's satisfaction, and also for the purpose of the hereafter. So now my purpose can already fulfilled, and your purpose of learning is still on the way. So you see how these two scholars were debating. Of course, the second scholar, what he said actually makes sense, because there is no other reason other than fulfilling what Creator has created him for, fulfilling the need. I mean, the fulfilling the passion of learning something other than fulfilling the basic need. There's a differences. So the second scholar, even though he is a rich person, but what he says is actually makes sense, because he actually did better than the first scholar. So now let me tell you who is these two scholars. The first scholar, who was poor, his name was Sheikh al-Baji. Sheikh al-Baji, he was a Maliki scholar. The second scholar that I told you, who was a rich person who had a family, rich family and all the background he had, he was actually the scholar of today's discussion, who is Ibn Hazm. So Ibn Hazm, so now you can clearly see Ibn Hazm was a rich person because of his family background, and he is from, his full name is Ali ibn Abu Umar Ahmad ibn Sa'id ibn Hazm al-Qurtubi al-Andalusi, commonly referred to as an Ibn Hazm. So he was born in 384 Hijri, corresponding to 994 Miladi in Cordoba. Cordoba is actually the Spanish name. Then you have Cordoba, the Arabic name, Spain or Andalus or at that time. So I was saying to you that he had a very wealthy and good family background because his father used to be the wazir of, maybe he was wazir like three times, administrative positions. He was actually supporting the Abbasid rule of that time. That time it was Al-Mansur and his son Al-Muzaffar, and then Hisham the second, the third, then later Abdul Rahman the second and third. So these were the political background of the family, and so it was in fact the women at home, whether it is the his mother or the slaves of that time, they used to teach him, especially Quran is even the hafadhan, he did at home by the help of these women. So I think he had a very good, but of course not every time, whatever that he had at the adolescent, not necessarily the same situation has to be at the end of his life. The things changed when his father passed away, when Ibn Hazm was 18 year old. So that you see, let me just give you some background of the geographical background. We are talking about Andalusia, right? We're talking about Andalusia. Remember when I talked to you about Abu Ubaid last time, I told you that he was from Khurasan, right? You know what happened to Khurasan today and what was Khurasan last time. I think I told you, because last time Khurasan was part of the entire Iran and Afghanistan and Turkmenistan, the entire region, the entire is like a huge country in Central Asia. But today Khurasan is being, you can see how it's been shrinked. You know, if you really want to see the historical shrinking, then you can clearly see how big was Khurasan and then become small and small and small, shrinking and shrinking and shrinking. Now it became just a province in Iran. It's a province. It's like a state, like, you know, we have it in Malaysia, like whether it is Penang or Pahang or you know, maybe Perlis, I think the smallest one, right? So Alostar, Perlis. Okay, so now you can see that Khurasan has become that small. The same thing happened to Andalus. So now you need to know, if you really want to see exactly the real Andalus, the real Cordoba of that time, starting from the Umayyad period, because, you know, as I told you, in Umayyad period, before Abbasid, the expansion of Islamic territory, starting from this end, which is Andalusia, Cordoba, this end, which is actually today's Europe, yeah? So you have Spain today, right? So if you look into the map, and if you are strictly looking into Mecca and Medina in your map, you can see on your left side, on your left, you can see Turkey, France, and then Spain, right? so that until the Spain, especially the entire peninsula of Iberia, they call it Iberia, I-B-E-R-I-A, I guess. So if you look into that, as peninsula of Iberia has become Muslims, has become, you know, Muslim, because those days the expansion being there until this side of, you know, Khorasan, then later went to Afghanistan, and then, you know, Sindh until India. It happened, most of the expansion happened in the Umayyad period, especially the Khilafah of Walid bin Abdul Malik. Right, so I told you earlier, you have Umayyad comes from Muawiyah ibn Abu Sufyan, then you have Yazid, then you have Muawiyah again, all right, and then you have Marwan bin Hakam, then Abdul Malik bin Marwan, then the son of Abdul Malik is one of them. There were many sons. One of them is Hisham, the other ones was Sulaiman. Okay, this one was, I'm talking Al-Walid bin Abdul Malik. All right, so he was expanding the territory. So now, if I have to tell you the your right, your left side of the map, you look into that Andalusia. So Andalus, those days, where the entire Iberia, Iberian Peninsula. You will have, you may have the Cordoba Caliphate, Cordoba, the entire thing, later Granada, and then there are so many places over there. But today, if you look into Andalus, right, if you look into today's Andalus, and then it has become like today's Khorasan. So this is what I'm trying to make an analogy to you. On your right side of the map, if you look into Makkah and Medina, on your right side of the map, you have Iran, right? You have Khorasan. Khorasan has become shrinking, become so small, has become a province. Now the same thing on your left side, if you look into today's modern map, then Andalus has become shrinking, then only the name Andalus is there. Maybe it's, today is maybe a province, tomorrow is maybe a city. So this is what actually happened. It's nobody has to blame on it. It is the our fall of civilization, Islamic, especially Islamic civilization. I believe we should all know our civilization, how it went, how it was, right? This is all related. We need to know that whether we live in a peaceful country, of course, alhamdulillah, right? We are now practicing Muslims, alhamdulillah. But it came all the way from so many sacrifices that people made, right? If those Arabs didn't do those sacrifices, they didn't do the expansion of territory, then we couldn't be a Muslim today, that what we are practicing today. We could be Buddhist or Hindu or Christians, right, or some others, because our regions were full of non-Muslims like 1,000 years ago, right? Alhamdulillah, today our region full of Muslims is all because of those people, Arabs and non-Arabs, expansion territory, for taking their, bringing their ilm, knowledge, do the proper tabligh, balagh. What I mean by balagh is actually Prophet ﷺ said, balighu anni walau ayah. Prophet said this during the Hajjat al-Wida, the last sermon of Hajj. He said to people, whatever you learn from me, whatever you heard, you listened from me, go and take that, and then go and preach, convey that message to somebody. Do not keep it with you. So scholars written some places, they said, after this statement of Prophet ﷺ, the companions, wherever they were facing, their camels were facing, they just started traveling to that place, just to follow prophetic statement. They went to those places and then they started doing this al-balagh. That's the reason why, subhanallah, today we are all Muslims. We should be proud of it. And alhamdulillah, this is the reason why we today, our territory has become, we are becoming Muslims, alhamdulillah. So now I'm talking about Andalus. So this is the Andalus that I just want to give it to you. The similar thing what happened to Khurasan, and that's what happened today to Andalus. So this is a scholar. This scholar, now you have seen the scholar Abu Ubaid from the other side, right? The Persian side, right? But this man is actually, even though Ibn Hazm says his origin comes from Persia, but of course he lives and his forefathers, his grandfather lived in Andalusia. This is totally the other side, the European side of Muslim. You understand? This is the other one was Asian side of Muslim. We talked about it last time. This time you're talking about a European Muslim, which is Ibn Hazm. All right. So however, during which Ibn Hazm lived was a period of decisive crisis for Andalusia. As a result, it was caused negative effect for the family of Ibn Hazm. He died in 456 Hijri in his village in Mount Al-Hisham near Seville. If you look Seville, I think in fact those days those days of Andalusia also consisting today's Portugal. The Portugal also, this is the near Seville, if I pronounce correctly, Seville. So this is a place is near to the Portugal. So I think I know most of you love football. I think some of you are fans of what's his name? I think I don't know, the name suddenly is not coming to me. There is a very famous footballer of Portugal. Ronaldo? I think Ronaldo or something. I think most of you, I think you know, you were laughing at me, right? All right. So so this is what I'm saying. This is a part of, you know, all this region where Andalusia those days. So he lived there and then he died there. Okay, now let's continue to the next slide. Okay, when Ibn Hazm entered a semi-retirement situation, hence devoting his efforts towards intellectual work, teaching and writing various works. Besides that, with his great personality, Ibn Hazm attained respect as one of the greatest thinkers in the Arab Muslim civilization. There are six factors leading him to be endowed with the position of Al-Imamah, possessing personal traits such as strength and rigor of memory, sharpness in thought and words, or highly commendable powers, observation and analysis. All right. So so of course there were many personalities of him. So before I go into his economic thought of his positions and all, I would love to talk to you about his fiqh background. All right. Okay. I think here you can see his okay, let me also read these slides to you before I go to that. Having the benefit undergoing a thorough education coupled with his personal enthusiasm to learn and indulge in current concern, for instance, traditions, grammar, lexicography, rhetoric, dialectic, and theology. Also, command over various foreign languages, benefiting from conducive environment, notably and wealthy position family. Active participations as a wazir in public affairs, administrations, military and political concerns, positively reacting to his opposition by bearing upon himself. So this is all actually, it came because of his family background. He is also, he had a very good teachers because of his family background. He was, he spent a lot of time learning. In fact, sometime he go and see, sit in this circle. Sometimes he also share his knowledge. Sometimes people would say, you are not the expert in this field, you are not supposed to share your knowledge with us. Then he go back to his home and then he shut the door, he closed the room, and then he stay inside until he become the expert. He read and read and read, he exercise, then come back and then come back to the same circle and then share his knowledge, and everybody surprised to see him that he had vast experiences, I mean the knowledge and all. So his position, Yes, he proved to be a forceful literary historian, philologist, philologist actually a language specialist, rhetoricist, jurist, philosopher, and theologian. As I told you, he had worked, he has many works as 400, comprising 80,000 sheets, but only 40 of them are still existing. He was also followed his father's footsteps as wazir for three different occasions, such as below. So these are the three different occasions he was also a wazir to the administration. He was a wazir to Abdurrahman the fourth, Al-Murtada. Then he was a wazir to the Abdurrahman the fifth, Al-Mustazir. Then he was a wazir again under Hisham al-Mu'tad, right? So he didn't directly involved in the state administration, but he was there as the wazir helping and also doing all this related work with regard to fiqh and zakat and taxes and all. So before I jump into Ibn Hazm's economic ideas, so this is what you see right now in the screen. This is the economic ideas, and these are the four areas that he has contributed in his book called Muhalla bil Athar. So before we see in that, so I just want to give you his background of his fiqh. I told you this is the second thing that I wanted to bring it to you, why he was called Ibn Hazm al-Dahiri. This is something, you know, we need to know this. This is amazing because there are many scholars in Sharia and fiqh related expertise, but not everybody actually same in the same degree, same level of expertise. You know, they had a differences and a difference. Different routes and methodology, which actually in a way completes our deen, completes our religion. You know, how? Because let's say if entire world are full of Americans, so just imagine if the entire world is full of Japanese, right? If the entire world is full of Indians, for example, look like me, right? The world is not a better place. You can see, because the world is the better place because we are having the differences. So differences always complete, differences always helps each other, so that you can clearly see what is right, what is wrong, what is blue, what is green, right? You have different colors. That's how the life become colorful. Otherwise, have you seen the black and white? I don't know whether have you seen the black and white movies or black and white TV shows, right? Myself also, I didn't see directly, but I have seen something that recorded. Perhaps my father has seen those black and white. So what I'm saying, that if there is a color, yeah, it's a colorful, because there are many varieties of color. That's how completes. So now, coming back to differences in the scholarship, it always complete the academy. So now, when I am talking to you about, I'm talking to you this Ibn Hazm al-Dahiri, it's completely different mazhab other than the four mazhab we have. Basically, I think you know the usul al-fiqh. I think you learned, most of you. I think all of you know the primary sources, which is Quran and Sunnah, right? And then you have the secondary sources. I think you remember what I'm talking, the secondary sources starting from Ijma', Qiyas, Istihsan, right? Saddu al-Dara'i', right? There are so many the secondary sources that we discussed, especially in Fiqh 1 and Fiqh 2, I think you remember. Or maybe the student who went to Usul al-Fiqh 1, Usul al-Fiqh 2. So the most of the secondary sources, right, you learn a lot about it, especially the special concern given to Ijma' and Qiyas. You know that how important Qiyas, analogy, in fiqh al-ibadat and fiqh al-mu'amalat today, right? All right. So now, when it comes to Ibn Hazm al-Dahiri, it's different, because to him, the usul al-fiqh, the sources are only three. The three. He add one more later. I will tell you what is it. The three is actually what Quran, Sunnah, and Ijma. So to him, it's only these three. So whatever comes in Quran, he clearly accept. Whatever in Hadith and Sunnah, he clearly accept. And then whatever the Ijma we call it. Ijma means is what whatever that the most of the scholars of the Ummah. Or gathered and they are together in one thing, then it's become ijma, unanimous. So because Prophet ﷺ said, my ummah, most of the ummah will not agree unanimously in one thing. I mean, they will not agree in the wrong thing. They always agree in the good thing, right? So based on the hadith, so he accept ijma. And then there is one more thing which is called istishab. If you remember, the permissibility, everything is permissible unless is prohibited. Yeah, so he took that seriously, very seriously. So now the problem here is he doesn't believe in qiyas, right? So now what he says if Allah prohibited wine, and we agree as other scholars of fiqh, most of them they say Allah has prohibited wine because of the intoxication, right? As long as the intoxication is the key, the reason of prohibition, then the same intoxication you get it in any other drinks or stuff like that, it is also kind of prohibited. So that is an analogy, for example, always given this analogy, right? So so now to him, he won't take that analogy. He says that Allah has prohibited wine, so we just agree he has prohibited. You don't have to do the qiyas and then bring some other thing into that. Maybe it could be prohibited. He says it is. He doesn't say that all of the intoxications are halal. He doesn't say that. He says that yeah, it could be prohibited because of the government, the administrator, the khalifa, or the qazi. He actually can stop people drinking that kind of other than wine, which is intoxicated. He can stop them drinking. He has all the right to stop them, but not because of Quranic verse. All right, he doesn't agree to, you know, go and drink anything you want. It's not like that. He says that the reason of prohibition is not from the Quran, because the Quran clearly talks about wine means wine, khamr, right? The Quran used the word khamr. The same thing goes to any other thing that today we have extracted usul al-fiqh, especially the analogy, and we are putting it to that. So he doesn't agree, except the fact that he agrees only is this hab, which means that everything is halal. Statement from Quran and Sunnah says this is prohibited, then that is prohibited. But of course, it's a kind of idea of called Zahiri. Zahiri means apparently. You just look into, you don't have to go deep and come up with your own idea. So he, in a way, he stops putting your intellectual ijtihad into Quran and Sunnah, because he still feels that that is the sacred. It is quite sacred. You should not be disturbing those contents. For that reason, other than that, he himself is a great scholar. He himself has done so many, you know, thinking and so many thing in language, in philosophy. Language and in philosophy, in some other grammar, for example. He has done so many ijtihad. But when it comes to Quran and Sunnah, he doesn't want to do that because he doesn't feel right to use our own analogy to say this is haram and this is halal. And he clearly thinks that halal and haram is clearly comes from the creator, the shari', the legislator. and also supporting the hadith saying that al-halalu bayyinun wal-haramu bayyinun wa baynahuma mushtabahat. So he says clearly the hadith that halal is very clear and also haram is very clear. If you are having something in this between, it becomes mutashabihat. So he might say, if you ask him, is it cocaine is haram or halal, he will not say it's haram, but he will say some mutashabihat, or maybe it is haram because of the administrator, the politics, the government, the qazi say it is prohibited, then it becomes prohibited. Other than that, from Quran, it is not prohibited. This is what his idea, but this idea didn't go well. And you can clearly see not many people were ready to follow this idea of fiqh, but it doesn't mean that Sheikh Ibn Hazm al-Tahiri, he has nothing to do with fiqh. He has so many things to do with fiqh. Because of his approach, there were so many critical analysis has been done, and then you can see, you know, sometimes it's like this. When you open the door for some sort of things, for example, yeah, let me give you an example. You have a child or you have a siblings and you are opening the door for him, asking him, okay, you can do whatever with your iPad. I'm just giving you the permission to do this. You critically think and then do with this iPad or the phone, right? So it comes like after some times he was doing critically, doing this, doing that. But after 2-3 months, he becomes addicted to the games. He is not actually doing anything productive. He is addicted to something. He is actually deep inside. Then what you have to do? You have to take back the iPad, or maybe you have to use some idea. You have to bring some idea whereby he actually can control himself. So this is all part of the game. Yeah. So the same thing now, maybe by the time of Ibn Hazm, he was not happy with the people who always prefer their analogy more than the Quranic verses. People doesn't want to. Maybe he saw some group of people in his place that without control, people actually criticize. They call it giving interpretation without any basis of Quran and Hadith. Or maybe there's a Quran and Hadith, but people went far. They raised the bar of explaining into something. You know, people do that sometimes. People they don't even realize sometimes. There is a, for example, if there is a strike. There is a straight prohibition to something in Quran. For example, وَلَا تَقْرَبُ الزِّنَا. Allah said, do not go even near to adultery, right? Zina, right? So you can clearly see how prohibited it is, right? So someone may come and say, using his idea, and he say that, that's not the meaning of word zina. Zina means this. It is not adultery. It is something like that. You see that? So maybe someone can come and say, okay, maybe zina is something that when you pay, then it becomes zina. If you don't pay, it becomes halal. So you see that? This kind of nasty ideas. People come with their own idea of intellectual. It's possible because when you are allowed to do ijtihad, but at the same time, you have to be very careful with your ijtihad, because you see this intellectuality can lead you to good things. It also can lead you to the bad thing. One example I can give you. You see the weapons that we have created, the human mind has created, the intellectual of the people. Maybe perhaps we have given them Nobel Prize of creating such thing. But today, do you think those weapons are helping? No, those weapons are actually killing people, destroying people. It's supposed to be helping, but it is not helping. So whatever it is that we are doing, we are going to the space, we are using our intellectual thing today, especially economics, productions, and you see the things like whether it is a transportation, the far we are going, the speed we are going, it is all in a way, you see, there is also a good thing, it's also a bad thing. Right, you can see clearly now we are using the computers, which is a good thing, but at the same time, the same thing can also look into your privacy, right? take your bank account details and all, and people are hacking, doing scams and everything. So you can, this is what I'm saying, there is also a good side, there's also a bad side, right? If there is a security police, at the same time there is also thief and people who are ready to steal, right? So you can clearly see that the different, this, all these people are having the fight between them, between, this is the fight between the good and bad. It's always there. That's why it is very important that we have to control our intellectual power to do only for the good things. So maybe perhaps those days, Ibn Hazm's period, maybe in Andalus, people were doing this kind of things. He was not very happy with those kind of things. So yeah, but it doesn't mean that he doesn't understand Quran and Sunnah. He clearly understands Quran and Sunnah. In fact, he was following Shafi'i Mazhab for some time. And he was still good with the Shafi'i Mazhab, because the Shafi'i Mazhab is actually following Quran and Sunnah equally, because they said that the divine guidance comes from Quran and Sunnah as equal as possible. You need to take both of them together. But when it comes to Hanafi Mazhab, there's a slight difference. They always prioritize Quran over Sunnah, because they said Sunnah can be interpreted according to the situations, according to the reasons and background of that hadith. The hadiths were given because of this reason. I think I told you about this in the first few classes of all hadiths. For what reason this hadith came, and we need to look into that hadith. And because in fact, Sheikh Hazrat Umar ibn Khattab, even though he is a very good follower of Sunnah, but he also didn't, there are few places he said he knows the idea of hadith, for what purpose Prophet said that, right? And then he said that I'm following the Quran for this sake. It's a purpose of following Quran for this, especially when he has to distribute the lands to the Muhajirin. Yeah, he was doing the opposite of the hadith. But because the hadith, he knows the hadith, why it was mentioned, for what purpose it was mentioned. But in order to do the right thing, he followed the Quran. So there are a few reasons for how it has to be done. So Hanafis, most of the Hanafis, their methodology, their style is goes with, you know, this kind of special. So now when it comes to Quran and Sunnah, is equally following is Shafi'i Mazhab. He was actually a Shafi'i before he became a Tahiri, and later he was coming out from Shafi'i, and then he wanted to criticize the idea of, you know, bringing too much opinions, especially the Hanafi. He become totally against of Hanafis because of bringing so much of ideas and all, and that's how he became a Zahiri. Yeah, all right. So now you understand his background, his fiqhi background, who is he and what he's been doing. Now let's see how he has contributed to economic ideas. Right, Ibn Hazm is an example of what can be referred to as total ulama, that is those whose expertise in many issues of the human life are not restricted to that of conceptual juristic viewpoints, but rather are able to provide an Islamic based opinion and rational on the more mundane concerns. So there are four economic concerns that we can talk about it. First one is basic needs and poverty. Yes, he is very much concerned about this basic food, drink, clothing and shelter. In fact, he says if the rich people are rich people because they are having all sort of materials, resources and all, it doesn't mean that they can only use it. They're supposed to be give and help the poor people to eliminate the poverty, if in case they are not ready to help poor people to eliminate poverty, the government should intervene, the government should interfere and take the money from them and then pay to the poor people. See, this is the idea of socialism that I was telling you earlier. He was also criticized as a socialistic scholar, but there are good side and bad side, of course. Socialism, if you concern this is a socialism, then in fact zakat also a kind of socialism. Right. Of course, in Islam, there are few parts of socialism is always an impact. But it doesn't mean that we are completely following socialism or we are completely following capitalism. Yeah, because Islam is Islam, right? The rest of the things all came later. So you need to look in that way. He said, yeah, we need to collect zakat from people, the rich people, in order to fulfill the basic needs of poor people. If in case zakat is not efficient to satisfy the basic needs of the poor, tax should be levied upon the rich Muslims to provide the poor Muslims with enough food, reasonable clothing and accommodation. So this is what his idea. And also, yeah, the same thing here, not fulfillment of the basic needs. Zakah, when it comes to zakah, he also had a few different ideas. Like most of the scholars, whatever they said, okay, they agree. He agree with them because as long as if Prophet ﷺ said you have to pay this amount of zakah for this, you have to pay this amount of zakah. But it will be quite strange, you know. It will be quite different if Ibn Hazm lives today, because you can see Prophet ﷺ was telling zakah for agriculture, zakah for livestock, zakah for those vegetables and then honey and those things, okay. But today it's we are living in a different world. It's a corporate world. So now we have corporate agricultural products, we have business dealings, we have petrol, and you know, we have diesels and crude oil. But if Ibn Hazm Zahiri lives today's world, and he will be saying that you don't have to pay zakat for petrol, because he will be clearly saying, because there is no evidence from Quran and Sunnah to pay directly unless if you use analogy, qiyas, right? So yes, that one is the thing. So he was quite forward. He says that whatever Prophet ﷺ said, you have to pay zakat. But there's one thing that he said, which is something different from other scholars. He said, let's say you are supposed to.
Sir, I think you turned off your mic.
Okay, sorry, can you hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Oh, see, I don't know how it happened. Since when I turn off?
I think not too long ago.
All right. Did I talk to you about land channel theories? Did
Not
I?
yet.
Okay. What was the last thing you heard from me? Zakat. Zakat was the last thing. Okay, good. Okay, so I'm talking about the land. So I was saying there are also some different idea. There are also some differences that he is having, other than others, the different theories that he is holding, while other scholars are holding different theories. One of them is actually, he said, any person who holds land must cultivate it himself or give it to another tiller without charging him any rent or recompense. So he's trying to say that if you have land, yes, you are allowed to give it for rent, but you are not allowed to become the partner of the crop. Let's say we talk about muzara'a, am I right? The partnership in muzara'a. And he says that this kind of partnership, because the sharing is not possible between the landlord and the partner, the one who work hard for it. He says that because the person's effort is the person's the one who work hard, he put all the efforts, so he has to take the entire share. So this is something against of the majority scholars, as you know how we do mudaraba and musharaka. So this is something, he says that if a person work hard, he gets everything. So this is also another kind of socialistic idea, right? So this is also socialistic, socialism, people are so concerned about it. He was having this kind of thought. And I think, yeah, let me just, all right. Yeah, I think that's all for today. And let me just give you the attendance.